Nowadays, it is almost essential to own a smartphone, in order to check on the latest memes, but also to connect with the world easily. Only problem is that over time my smartphones always got slower, and their battery capacities dropped rapidly. And since Samsung is releasing new smartphone models yearly, which is quite tempting to say the least, I got myself a Galaxy S7 about a year ago, while leaving my Galaxy S6 behind. But simply throwing my old smartphone in the trash is not an option for me. So in this video, let's dissect it in order to find out which smartphone components we can use for electronics projects. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, who produce prototype PCBs quick and low priced. So feel free to upload your Gerber files to order your PCBs. And while you're at it, also try out their new shipping methods, which is a bit cheaper than usual. To start off this teardown, I removed the backside of the phone with a flathead screwdriver, and then continued by removing all the Phillips head screws near the edge of the phone. Afterwards, through the help of a plastic spatula and a lot of pushing around, I separated the metal housing of the phone from the main electronics. For now though, I focused on the metal housing parts, which honestly did not offer lots of components. But I decided to remove this black piece of plastic with wires attached to it, as well as the volume up, volume down, and power push buttons. Now the push buttons themselves are truly tiny, but through their attached breakout copper pads, we can easily confirm that they are still usable, but I highly doubt that I will ever find a suitable project for them. The black piece of plastic, however, is according to its outer look and the fact that it features a small resistance between its copper pads, most certainly a coil, which is used to wirelessly charge the phone. If you're not familiar with this technology, then feel free to watch my videos about the subject, to not only understand how it works, but also to create your own wireless energy transfer system. With it, we can tune the frequency of a square wave voltage applied to a transmitter coil to the frequency which is commonly used with such commercial wireless chargers, which is around 147 kHz, and thus use our salvage coil as a receiver to, for example, light up this LED. So, in a nutshell, I think the salvage coil can easily be utilized in wireless power projects. Next, I disconnected the battery and once again used the plastic spatula to completely remove it. As you can see, it comes with a nominal voltage of 3.85 volts and a capacity of 2700 mAh, which equals 10.4 watt-hours of energy. That means, as an example, we could power a 5 volt 100 mAh project for around 20 hours. Which is not half bad. The only thing holding us back is this tiny connector. So I simply removed the wrapping of the battery in order to get rid of it, and thus I will be able to use this battery easily in future projects. Moving on, I removed the front camera of the phone as well as all the connectors from the PCBs, and then lifted them out one after the other. At the end, I used the plastic spatula to separate the phone screen from the remaining plastic enclosure, which partly destroyed the flexible PCB, but more about that later. For now though, I finished my teardown by removing the home button, a weird component which looks like a coin cell, and finally the speaker. The speaker unit as well as the home button come with other components on their flex PCBs, and thus feature those tiny complicated connectors, which means they're not easy to use and thus not worth salvaging for my next projects. The small coin cell component, however, looked interesting, and its resistance of around 23 ohms was easily measurable through its copper pads. Now, since the component did not react to DC voltage, I hooked it up to a function generator to find out that it also does not serve as a decent speaker. But later I found out that by using a square wave with a frequency of 150 Hz, the component starts vibrating intensely, which makes it interesting for future projects as a kind of alarm. So last, but definitely not least, after removing the back camera module from the main electronics, it was finally time to have a look at them. That is why I removed the top of all the metal cages, and sometimes the entire cages, in order to determine the labels of all the ICs. Which brings me to the depressing parts of this video. ICs, like this Maxim MAX98505, which is a Class DG audio amp, or for example this Maxim MAX77843 PMIC, which is used to charge the battery over USB, are so hard to properly desolder and reuse that due to their relatively low prices, they're simply not worth salvaging. And other ICs, which are directly developed by Samsung, do not come with public data sheets. So the effort of firstly reverse engineering the IC and then reusing it is also not worth it. So in a nutshell, all of the components on the PCBs are not worth salvaging for my future electronics projects. At least if I think economically. And that brings me to the two camera modules as well as to the screen, which certainly come with tempting technical specifications. But as you can see, the screen does not come with an HDMI input, and the cameras not with an HDMI output, only with lots of pins to work with. The screen's interface could be, for example, a display serial interface, or DSI, which, unlike HDMI, is not completely standardized. That means, while for HDMI we know which pin serves which purpose, the connector of the DSI screen can feature different pinouts depending on the manufacturer. That, on the other hand, means we would have to find out which pin fulfills which function and then create a suitable circuit that converts our HDMI signals into DSI compatible signals. Needless to say, this is a ton of work and definitely not worth it. But if you're still eager to try it out, then have a look at this project I found on Hackaday. The camera modules can also come with such an interface, known as CSI, or Camera Serial Interface, which comes with the exact same problems, and thus is not worth salvaging as well. So all in all, from all those removed components, only these few ones are, in my opinion, worth salvaging, which is a bit sad, but still better than no salvage parts at all. I hope you enjoyed this video. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and activating the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!